another draft physics video. Response to... yes, it's not much point, but we'll go over some of this crap. I guess I don't need to show anything immediately, so still camera for a change. Took notes. So let's just go through it, and I'll have to try to remember how to read my notes, of course. Okay, so he says... So first, there was some philosophy crap thrown in. So, you know, it's sort of his opinion that his fables are data. You know, that you can just make up any kind of story, and that's data. And, you know, my argument would be is that it's garbage, and it creates garbage. So they quote me as saying bacteria-brained, as if we have, like I ever said, that our brain is like a bacterium's brain or something, when of course I said exactly the opposite. I said we're bacteria with brains. That means basically that we have a very crude motivational desire, a very crude mechanism that makes us feed in the world like a bacterium, but we have the advantage of having a brain. So he couldn't even paraphrase that correctly, because he has to slander everything, because making an honest argument, he would lose. So he has to make a dishonest argument. It's always been his tactic. Data says... Oh dear. Data says... there's got Thursday. Yeah, I don't think so. I guess I'll have to come back to that one. Data says, well, I suppose it doesn't matter. I mean, I just have to learn how to write in printing or something. I don't know if that would even save it, actually. It says, trees get thirsty. That was it. I was making sort of a joke. So by his data set, you know, his little film strip, you know, he's already put in a bunch of facts, you know, and that because trees get dry, he's associate, well, dry must make you thirsty, because trees must have a brain, they must be feeling thirsty, you know, that kind of nonsense. If they look like they should be thirsty, cactuses look awful thirsty. Anyway, okay, then he quotes me as saying, I trust my intuition, you know, so again, this is another, it's just such a grotesque slander. I've made actual videos on the subject of intuition, actual videos, many of them, pointing out how it's always better to think more. I did videos with think in the videos, because yes, thinking is a good thing. No, intuition sucks. I've made many, many, many videos saying your intuition is shit. It's usually a crude mechanism that produces your intuition. And your better judgment's going to take a little bit of thought to compile evidence and weigh it. So, just more bullshit, more lies. So he thinks it's my God is intuition. No, my God is reasoning. And when the story sounds preposterous, when somebody walks into a courtroom and says, well, fuck the evidence. I have a theory. The invisible man did it. And that's essentially what physics is caused. Everything is being caused by the invisible man. We have Heisenberg over here. We got Huygens. We got dark matter. We got dark energy. And now we even have this special relativity crap where not only are you moving slower, like the mechanisms are moving slower, but now you can make them do two things at the same time. Yeah. Physically do two different things. So anyway, just bullshit. So Heisenberg is the rational dot. So I guess, you know, I was just making the point that, you know, I'm arguing that the only part of this conversation I want to have about any kind of philosophy of science, as I pointed out, is it's just a trial. It's just a weighing of evidence. The evidence is logic. So if you have enough facts, you don't need logic anymore, because the facts connect the dots for you. That seems like a pretty simple statement, right? If you have an abundance of facts, you don't even have to connect the dots, because you can see the image without even drawing the lines. You don't have enough dots, well then you got to draw the lines. And you got to be careful how you draw them. And I'd say things like Heisenberg is not being careful. Alright. I do dishonest science. So he says I've done something dishonest. And I argue that that's just absolute bullshit. So, you know, I can't see, what am I going to do? No, I don't beat my wife. Just idiotic. All right. I wasn't, let's see, philosophy of, so again, the science, the philosophy of science thing came again. I was doing, or trying to, yeah, so the argument was, look, just give me arguments. I mean, I'm making arguments about how your evidence is weak, okay? And I've submitted the evidence to the jury, so to speak, and they can do what they will with it. I mean, I've shown Feynman misdescribing reality over and over. So I'll play the end of his video because he's going to defend those incredible mischaracterizations of the evidence and try to make them credible when they're not credible. They're huge distortions for the purpose of propaganda. And that's all. Their story doesn't make any sense if they use the single slit as example, as I've pointed out. Then their story looks a lot like a God theory. So I didn't bring up any of this philosophy of science crap, and as I've stated before, wouldn't even consider the word philosophy put in those contexts correct. Philosophy, in my opinion, is science. It's the same deduction. It's the same trial. You collect the evidence of reality, and you put the evidence together and compile a theory. There's nothing else. And again, their philosophy has something to do with utility and whether they can eat it. So again, they don't give a shit about the truth. They're not seeking the truth. They're seeking an answer that makes their life better. That's not, in my opinion, doing anything called a fair trial. Convicting the guy because, hey, he's a criminal anyway, you know, that kind of thing, it's just bullshit. Nobody likes him, so yeah, put him in jail. Who cares? And that's in the circumstance of his, the evidence he's presented that is just grotesquely dishonest, like his diffraction wave evidence. So he's saying having any, now he puts it in my, because I complain about the fact that I'm not talking about how to conduct a trial, I'm just want to get to it. That he's saying, I don't care about having a fair trial. No, I care, but it's just obvious you can't do that in this context. So I'm just saying, fuck it. I don't want to have an argument about why I'm not going to be worried about whether or not my theory says it's okay to eat hamburgers, because my theory is not going to say that. I don't care whether my theory has any utility. I don't care whether it even predicts anything. I just care whether it's a more rational explanation of the available evidence and putting it together. It's a better theory of how the dots should be connected. That's all I care about. Let's see. No, I am saying do your BS lawyer tricks. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying go ahead and you lie, you distort the evidence, you defend distortions in the evidence, you go ahead and do that. And I'll just present that as the evidence in the trial. I just say, look, you saw this lawyer. You saw what he did to the evidence. You saw him present this bullshit examples. And you make all these gross accusations. Judge for yourself whether they have a case. I mean, if they're that desperate, they obviously don't have very good evidence. If they have to manufacture evidence, then they must not have any. Okay. So let the jury sort it out. Let's see. We managed to have the discussion thing. Okay, yeah, so then he was even making rationalizations for the Hoffa Day thing, like they actually ever did have an in-depth conversation regarding the merits of capitalism, which they never did. So that's just bullshit. No, they argued about how to argue, and they never really had the discussion. I'm talking about something on resolution. Okay, so now we're talking about when I was talking about the sun, the stars, and the fact that we, they're always going to be this resolution problem. And so he misunderstood. I don't care. I think when I said microscopes, he should have been figuring out that I wasn't talking about atmospheric haze from, telescopes having to go through an atmosphere. And obviously they try to reduce that as much as possible by putting them on top of mountains and whatnot. So that's not the subject. The subject is the resolution power, that you can't resolve two objects, for example, at a certain distance, they'll turn into one object, because we don't have the resolving power. And part of that resolution power is because there is the movement in everything. Everything is moving it out of focus. No, wrong word. It's creating well, it doesn't matter. I think you can understand the point is if there's a certain amount of jiggle in your subject and there's a certain amount of jiggle in the device receiving the information, that it can't receive the information. Too much movement and there's no resolution of the picture. If the camera's moving, it's not likely to get a good image. And so when you have a long telephoto lens on, you can't afford any movement at all, or your picture's fucked. That's what I was talking about. Let's see, find out on internet. Let's see. So I don't know what that was. I guess it's something about Brownian in motion or something. Anyway, I don't think it has anything to do with anything. So then there was this accusation of hypocrisy. I pointed out, okay, look, he's making an accusation that I'm a hypocrite. And he's saying my hypocrisy is that I'm presenting a theory that is just as much God-based or something. Like, it has just as silly an element in it. Like, I'm giving you bent space. So when I give you a theory based on a physical model of a simple ton that has maybe three functions, that's the same thing as giving you bent space as an explanation, or Heisenberg, or Huygens, or dark matter, that my constructs are just as supernatural. I've already made the list, right? I'm getting rid of all the extra dimensions. Time isn't a dimension, space isn't, no other dimensions. There's three dimensions, and I'm putting all the forces in those three dimensions. So I'm getting rid of all the dimensional sleight of hand. I'm getting rid of the bent space canard, this vacuum cleaner for which we have no explanation for where it gets its energy from. I'm explaining where the energy is coming from. And then I'm using that same energy to explain where the energy for magnetism comes from, and then where the energy comes to push electrons and protons together. And he's saying that's just as convoluted an explanation of reality as general relativity, bent space, Heisenberg, and Huygens, and dark matter. And so that's my hypocrisy, because my explanation is just as undetailed and incomplete as those explanations. And I'm arguing clearly, bent space, we get no information about how space does any of it. No mechanism whatsoever. No structure, nothing. We're just told the space bends, the meter moves, period. No mechanism required. Huygens, no mechanism. Heisenberg, obviously no mechanism. A randomized, I don't know where I am, whatever, the magic forces will tell me where I am, eventually, when I need to know. Yeah. Well, so anyway, so I think that's just I think it's idiotic to say there's hypocrisy. And more important is, my theory unifies, unlike your theory. Your theory has no unification. Mine unifies everything. So that's a huge difference. So even if mine was just as wacky as yours, the great thing about mine is it actually works as a unification theory, where yours fails dismally, the current model. Okay, so my invention doesn't explain anything, but bent space does. Yeah, right. Huygens is explained. Heisenberg is explained. None of these things are explained. All right. Their model provides nothing as explanation. My model essentially, I don't know exactly, but obviously mine does fit the evidence, and it also provides a simple physical explanation. No supernatural entities. No big movement without any explanation. And let's see, I don't know what polarization is, so that's his claim. I don't know what to say as an argument. We're just talking about a distinction, but obviously polarization creates an easy to understand distinction between, the jail bar description I gave. But there's lots of ways you could describe a difference between things. So I could say something is sloped, let's say. If something had an angle to it, and then something else had an angle that's the opposite angle, you could see, I have to put it in front of the camera. Well, I can move the camera. I don't know if it's that much worth it, but anyway, okay. If these two things were right-handed and left-handed, right, so when they're coming at each other and both of them are right-handed, you could kind of see that these two things could hit each other, and because of the way they're going to hit, they're going to end up going perpendicular to each other when they leave. You could see that it's a physical mechanism that makes that possible. So I'm just saying, it is as a description. Yeah, that was a bad idea. Just leave the camera alone, Gary. No pictures from this video. Hopefully. But whatever. I'm just saying, I've provided a simple mechanism, a distinction. There's two things. The two things behave differently. Is that too complicated? I don't think so. Is that Huygens? No, I don't think so. You said I was a hypocrite to suggest, I don't know what that is. Mechanisms, okay. And they're just as bad as your mechanisms, and I guess I'm arguing that there's no hypocrisy. I think the evidence of your mechanism is vacuous, non-existent, essentially, for all the important elements, and there's no physical construction. You can't even draw this crap. All right. Let's see. The wave function is the... Photon is in every... The wave function is the something photon, and I guess I would argue is you mean photons, because your wave function is created by a single photon that splits into two. So yeah, I was just going to make fun of his statement. So anyway, he just keeps saying that this wave thing is proven, and it's obviously I don't see how it has any substantial proof at all. Back to the friction argument. Okay, so look, the friction argument does deserve explanation, and I have sort of pointed out how I'm working on that part, because it has to do with the velocity argument. I mean, it really has to do with how things maintain velocity. So I've been thinking about radiation and the fact that there was alpha and beta and gamma radiation. So the gamma radiation is the force type radiation. It's made out of the tiny stuff, the quanta. The beta is electron based, and the alpha is nucleuses, basically, of helium. And these nucleuses do maintain velocity. So in my opinion, that's the biggest small thing that ever has real velocity, because I don't think beta particles are part of cosmic rays, but we'll have to see. I don't think electrons can travel any great distance without losing their velocity, because it requires you to have an actual material nucleus to maintain velocity. So the force obviously moves the speed of light, so all the gamma stuff's going the speed of light, and the alpha stuff is going lots of different speeds depending on the particular nucleus involved. It's able to maintain those velocities. So that would be the first elemental thing to explain the possession of force. But simply, the argument put simply is, okay, that we know when something is moved, it's moved by a force. And the force is essentially injected into it. So that means it gains mass in that direction. So it gains arrows, you could argue, in the direction that the force is pushing it. And it retains those force arrows, because force in the field can't kill force in something. light doesn't degrade as it passes through space. So it can go through all kinds of forces, and none of those forces degrade the light. It goes just as fast the first inch as it goes the last inch of a 10 billion mile journey. It doesn't slow down, it doesn't get eaten up by friction. So the force that's possessed by the space shuttle isn't going to be bothered by any friction problem. The only thing that can be bothered is the atoms, the matter bits. But the matter bits obviously are being pushed by the extra force, so the extra force isn't going away. Once the force is in something, it stays in the thing, as Newton would say, until something takes it away, until another force acts on the matter to release the previous force. And so, this whole friction problem really isn't a deal. And I sort of explained it, and he just mocked it, the idea of that, well, as you're gaining force, what you're doing is converting your dimensional substance, the stuff that's actually hitting the stuff that actually has friction. If you're making the blade thinner as you go faster, you could sort of understand that you're reducing the amount of friction. So you're allowed to keep going fast because you got rid of the thing that was causing the friction by the same percentage as your velocity. So as your velocity increases, it means you're losing stuff that would be frictional, that could be a potential element of friction. But anyway, so that's not satisfactory. But yes, I want to do a whole video on the very subject of velocity, momentum, inertia, and how matter manifests it, because that is important. But I'm just saying so he says my theory is absolutely no good. It's not even point. There's no point in even presenting it, because he said this is a catastrophic failure or something. This completely is impossible. You can never solve this problem, and he just mocks any explanations that do solve it. And so that's the joke here, is that yeah, they still don't want to hear it. They didn't want to hear about it 300 years ago, and they don't want to hear about it now. And so it's the same world. They have their religion, and they're glued to it. The ether theory people are glued to their ether theory. And it's just unfortunate that's how human beings function. Their subjectivity, their bacterial attachments are so strong, and they just won't, they won't change until they're absolutely, you have to force the space shuttle off the ground, and you have to force these people out of their closed-minded, narrow comfort zone, I guess you could call it. All right, sorry, that's enough on that. Yeah, like I said, I'll make a whole video on that whole subject. And then so he's back to the laser, and so he quotes me as the one saying, you say the laser would bend, when I'm saying exactly the opposite. This has to do with motion, and I'm saying the light always goes straight. He's the one arguing that, as the Earth moves, the laser beam moves with it, and so it always points in one place, because no matter which way it's moving, it's always going to point the way it's not the opposite of how it's moving, actually. Well, that wouldn't be consistent with his general relativity theory then. Well, anyway, I'm not saying laser beams would bend. I'm saying that if you're going to shoot the light perpendicularly and the perpendicular is leaving, so we're back to the hole in the spaceship argument, except on an earthly scale, and that light takes time to get from point A to point B, and if it gets to point B and point B has moved, well, obviously that should be visible. And so it's that laser argument. But obviously the point that has been made is that the laser beam diverges so much because of the fact of the Browning motion problem again, which I think is the explanation for that divergence, the fact that we can't make a precise enough laser, is for exactly that reason. It's moving too much. And that movement is fucking what would be the potential of the experiment. But we'll see. So that's his theory that light bends, not my theory. That the light carries momentum. So the things, you can make light not only go this way, you can make light go this way. You can give light more than one velocity. No. Okay, all particles we have tested so far have wave properties. So I think that one's very funny, because he just makes this claim, and he says these are wave properties, but they're really not. And so let's say they say that they've used these 69 atom buckyball things, pretty big clumps, and they've made a pattern that indicates, I mean, in my opinion, it's an incredibly weak pattern, but whatever. They've created an influence. And his and we already know that the only way you can explain the interference pattern is you have to create the second element, the second particle. So his argument is that atoms, a whole clump of matter with 69 atoms, somehow dematerializes, it's no longer matter, converts into two of something, the two things interfere with each other, and then the clump of matter reforms at the target. I mean, it was a silly explanation with photons, but don't you see how it gets sillier and sillier as you get bigger and bigger? That atoms Huygens, so he believes that atoms Huygens, they just send a single buckyball, it will dematerialize, turn into two buckyballs, and then shoot out and interfere with itself somehow as a wave, and then turn back into a buckyball. And that makes sense to you people. Sorry, not even close to a sale. So I make the accusation that they're basically saying you have to accept wave theory, and he claims that no, you don't, but then he just basically says you can't do math. This is what he says. Okay, mathematically impossible for you to create this on-off pattern, okay, with a particle theory. He says it's mathematically impossible. I don't know how he knows what's mathematically impossible. I mean, is that really possible to say ever as a rational scientist that you know something's mathematically impossible to describe a certain way? I mean, there's no way that particles could mathematically do the same thing. I mean, I've sort of pointed out that, yeah, well, the simple explanation is that there are electrons that's hitting, and the electrons move the light at exactly the same angles each, and so however many electrons you have, that's how many bars you have. Done. That mathematically will work. I don't think it's mathematically impossible. I think that's just a pile of shit as a statement. I mean, can you imagine, a careful Newton being that reckless and saying something that silly? I think it's mathematically impossible. No, I don't think so. Anyway. So simple force matter is putting a square peg in a round hole. Okay, so that's his argument. So me simplifying the relationship between force and matter and saying you can get rid of all the dimensions, get rid of random, get rid of any of this absence of cause and effect. You can have a real cause and effect, material universe made out of actual forces and actual quantizable force, and that unifies all of it. And that's trying to shove a square peg in a round hole. But dark matter isn't. Yeah, right. So, I mean, this is still all related to the hypocrisy argument somehow or other. So, reverse engineer non-material fixes to deal with their model. Yeah, some of this is all, some of it requires an obedience to what you know the evidence to be. So certainly when you're connecting these dots, you know what it can't be. So you don't connect dots that look like something it can't be. But it's not reverse engineering to, you know, there's certainly no hypocrisy in me pointing out that reverse engineering to the point where you create new dimensions is a lot more extravagant or supernatural an explanation than my materialistic explanation. I'm giving you physics in physics. I'm giving you a physical explanation. No bending, no crookery whatsoever. Anyway, he is in denial, and so, you know, he keeps saying I'm in denial, and, you know, it's clearly he's in denial. I mean, he's the one presenting the fake evidence. Again, I don't, they're giving you this extraordinary explanation. Heisenberg, Huygens, bent space, you know, general relativity, all this stuff. And all this stuff has no details of a mechanism. Not one single shred of a mechanism for the bent space. No mechanism for Huygens. No, nothing to explain how any of that happens. What physical things happen to cause these effects. And so my model is just as extraordinary. And it's just, you know, it's just nonsense. No mathematical coherency. Yeah. So again, you know, what can I argue? I can argue that I'm the one just pointing out that, no, I like all these variables. I pointed out what's really good about Newton's equation and what was really wrong with it was the idea of just combining the two forces as if they were the same force, and they're not. It's little things like that. But where exactly? So it's, again, he's saying that once we do math through a process where we create a fake process that, I don't know how to explain this, but that somehow he owns all mathematical relationships now. So because they have an underlying model and they have some accurate math, that because they can make their model fit math, no one else is allowed to make a model that uses the same math. You're never allowed to accept the relationships that exist between something. So the inverse square law, you can't explain it with some other mechanism because they own it somehow. And it's just nonsense. I mean, there's nothing in Einstein's mathematics except mass, velocity, and time. These are all things that exist in almost any model. You have to wait there, buddy. You've been a pain in the ass today. Every hour he wants something. I'm a hypocrite for finding whatever. I don't care. You wish to call me a hypocrite because I have a unification theory, you don't. My theory is dirt simple, yours is insanely complex. Mine reduces everything to simpler elemental functions. Yours has more complicated elemental functions. Whatever. Fuck you. So then he says, I changed the subject instead of dealing with this hypocrite argument, where, of course I dealt with it by just saying, I don't see any hypocrisy in me saying, in me engineering, the tiny bit of engineering I have done by describing four simple rules and like three different particles. I don't think that's over-engineered anywhere to the extent of Heisenberg, Huygens, bent space, and relativity theories. My dancing analogy, I don't think, is as extraordinary as, you know, Einstein's "you'll see the past move in front of you" kind of nonsense. So he was playing that part of the video, and then he was griping how I was changing the subject and how I'm running away from the question, all this stuff, and it's because he clicked on the wrong place in the video. So I put LOL in my notes because I was just, I mean, here he's accusing me of changing the subject when he changed the subject by playing the wrong part of the video. Fucking idiot. Doesn't want to accuser accusations. Anyway, you just say, how am I avoiding this contention? I'm saying, look, I don't even care. You want to say the two theories are equally complex? I'll say, fine, okay. They're equally made up. Okay, go ahead and make that accusation. I think it has nothing to do with the facts. But go ahead and make that accusation. The difference between my theory and the standard model is mine unifies. Yours does not. So mine still wins. And again, I'm going to argue that mine is dirt simple, and all physics. No extra dimensions, no superpowers, no unexplained functions and such. So anyway, he's got a part two, but I don't know if I'm going to bother. Oh, I wanted to play that one part. All right, so deal with this cat crap. Sorry. Cats, when they get old, they're just pain in the ass. Everything's a pain in the ass when it gets old. I find myself a little bit insufferable.
Some men misdescribe what happens in the two-slit experiment in the sense that they'll say, look, there's two slits, and if we cover one of them, in the sense.
Okay, so, all right, so look, I've made this argument over and over. I've played all these videos that, where they all misdescribe it, where they all never point out, no, you would expect that with a single slit, look, we block one slit, and yeah, you get a pattern because, yeah, it's a single slit, Newton's rings, that happens. There's a pattern. Instead of saying the honest truth, they always deceive.
You just get a lump, and if you cover the other one, you just get a lump.
The reason they say you just get a lump is because diffraction is really, really, diffraction lines are very subtle.
Okay, so I mean, how dishonest does this have to get? The single slit experiment is just as easy to do as the double slit experiment. I mean, frankly, it's easier, okay? There's fewer ways to fuck it up. They're exactly the same experiment. There's nothing subtle about it. You make the slit too narrow, there'll be no pattern. You make the slit too wide, there'll be no pattern. But if you make it anywhere within reasonable bounds, the single slit will create lots of lines, and if you make this reasonable, there'll be lots of lines, and yes, they'll be shaped a little bit different, a little different intensities at different points, but it's exactly the same pattern. It's just as easily to create one as the other. You can create a single slit with a single, with just a pen. I mean, in a sense, you know, that's why they don't, you know, when you really think about it, the double slit is sort of a fraud, because you really don't need these two barriers, in a sense. It really is the single impediment experiment. Because the math is exactly the same. See, the math doesn't have this distance in it. The distance of this slit is not in the math. This is the only distance they use, D, in the math, for the double slit. They don't care how wide this gets. Interesting. In my opinion. But anyway, so there's nothing complex about the single slit and creating the single slit pattern. So this, what is this? I mean, will any of you people be honest enough to say, yeah, well, Pyrrho shouldn't say that because that's just crap. And again, I played Professor Lewin saying it. This isn't about diffraction. This is an interference pattern, single slit interference.
And when they're talking about the lump, they're talking about the diffraction lump. And yes, there's some lines in it.
And yes, there's some lines in it, but there's no lines. There's no. They don't draw any of that. So I'm just saying, you're saying that there's something, they're trying to sell this as if the double slit's doing something special. And the point is, it's not doing any. If I showed somebody a single slit pattern, and I, you know, the average street a person on the street with say 30 bars in it, and I show them a double slit pattern with 30 bars in it, you think they're going to sit there and say, "Oh yeah, those are totally different things." Oh yeah, sure. No.
And you know that.
I mean, you know that. I mean, this is just, this again, I've drawn it, I've done everything I can. How many videos now have I made? I've drawn the two pictures of the patterns, the subtlety of the difference. I've pointed out how Professor Lewin, I've played him saying it. I mean, what else do I have to do here? I've shown all these physicists keep saying, look, when you cover one of the slits, it's just a lump. And it's not the truth. You cover one of the slits, there's a bar pattern, just like the one you're going to get with two slits. And so the real phenomenon to explain is the single slit, because you don't have this contrivance of some barrier that you have to decide to break the photon into two. because there's a barrier. Oh, I gotta make two photons because there's a barrier. Well, there's no excuse to make two anymore with the single slit. So then you have to invent this silly Huygens crap where you make a zillion new photons and then you pretend that all of them cancel out except this one and this one. So then you have two again. Now, if they had to do that with a straight face, okay, then people would say, yeah, quantum mechanics is bullshit. If that's quantum mechanics, then yeah, you people really are full of shit.
You have pictures of it from scientists, and Feynman knew that.
Okay, so Feynman knew it was okay to just plain lie. I mean, just forget about Newton's rings, forget about what you knew a single slit does, just draw it wrong, explain it wrong, because doing it the wrong way is doing it the right way. Fuck. I mean, you sit there and show them glaringly misrepresenting the fucking truth and they defend it. They defend the misrepresentations.
So dishonest with yourself.
Okay, so I'm the dishonest one, right? I'm the dishonest one for playing the clips, showing the deception, showing the single slit pattern, showing the double slit pattern, showing how the math doesn't have the distance, the width of the slit in it. I'm the dishonest person.
Since Newton over 300 years, that you don't get along. You get a pattern. So they misrepresent the truth, and that's okay. Misrepresenting the truth is okay. That's good science.
Okay, so no response to him from him. No, yes, that's exactly right. Yes, that is good science. You don't want to do science straight up. You don't want to tell people the truth, because if you told them the truth, then they would know you're full of shit.
Well, again, he makes the accusation. Where's the evidence backing it up? Oh, that's right, there is none.
He makes the accusation. He doesn't actually remember the accusation.
Wait, you just played your accusation so fast nobody could even hear it, but you just made the accusation again that I am dishonest. Where's my dishonesty? This isn't the hypocrisy argument, jackass. You can't even hear your own fucking accusation in this video, you stupid cunt. I mean, shit. I mean, how much of a goddamn cheater are you going to be? Now you're testifying in court that I don't know what the accusation is. Your accusation at this point in the video was that I am cheating the evidence, that I'm creating false evidence.
He doesn't remember what the accusation was. The accusation is that he also invents these artifacts.
Okay, now this isn't about an artifact. I'm not talking about inventing an artifact here. I'm making the exact, the accusation that they're misrepresenting the fucking truth. And then you claimed I did that. Where did I misrepresent the experiment? What experiment did I misrepresent? God, you're such a cunt.
Specifically right now. But I saw a video like 5 years ago where he was inventing these artifacts about geometry and these things were shaped like trapezoids.
Oh, well look, 5 years ago, yeah, that's right. It's taken a while to develop the theory. It's all been done openly and publicly. So there's no chicanery. I didn't have any special experimental cheats in the past. I didn't have any advantages. I just said, let's go with this particle thing and see where it goes. And I explained how it led me to magnetism and how it led to the now to a real good model of protons and electrons. And I don't think you're going to undo that really good model. I mean, this is a damn good model of attraction and repulsion. Damn good, damn fucking dirt simple, and it explains how you can have photons at different frequencies and that the energy level is based on the compression of the force. I mean, it's a damn good model, and you're not going to be able to break it with your fucking empty accusations.
He invents artifacts regularly. Right now, it's red.
Again, I don't know how to say it. This will be the last statement I'm going to make on this statement. He says that my theory is just as supernatural, just as UFO worthy, just as, what do you mean, dark matter? You mean dark because you got to hide the bogus trick of it, trick matter. I mean, you might as well just call it God matter or something, God of the gap matter. And my mine are the same thing. No, they're not.
And blue arrows. And the fact that for some reason they come in and out at right angles. And
yeah, well, that was and I gave reasons for that based on the kinetic principles. But regardless, you can you don't want to pay attention to those arguments, then fine. But you're not quoting my paper. You're not quoting my statements in a current video. So you're just claiming I said something or I believe something, but you're not demonstrating it with anything called evidence. Fucking
God. There's something called polarity. Those are artifacts.
Well, again, I'm saying they're not really artifacts. We know that light is polarized. So the idea that there may be shapes is you know, and contingent on which way the thing is oriented, you know, it's going to matter what happens to it. And I've already explained there's three dimensions, and the fact that there's a three-dimensional model of this thing, you could pretty easily imagine that electrons are, you know, going this way, and protons are doing the gate this way. And there's plenty of room in the universe for that kind of a model.
Just like virtual particles. Nobody's seen that they're real. The difference is with virtual...
Okay, the difference is there's no evidence that they exist. They're not a material description of a real thing. I'm giving you a thing. You're complaining because I say it's green or blue. You're saying that's the same thing as inventing a whole particle. Saying something, well, they're either green or they're blue. They're either going this way or they're going this way. You say saying that is the same thing as inventing a particle, inventing something for which they can't find any footprints or evidence that it exists. A fake thing.
Particles, even the physicists say, well, they're not real. These are calculation tools. That's why they call them virtual still, because they're not saying...
Yeah, they're not calculation tools. They don't have any way to get the force from one place to another without creating energy. So to avoid creating energy, they make fake energy, virtual energy, that they can just erase later. There, no problem. I fixed the conservation problem because I made something that's invisible. It's the invisible man. The invisible man did it. You can erase him after the murder.
And they're really there. But then some physicists talk like, no, it's really there. But it's not there. They're not, they call them virtual particles because in that case they're saying we think these are artifacts.
You can't call them artifacts if they're actually carrying a force from one place to another. I mean, that's just kind of silly. All right, so obviously the force had to get there through a mechanism. They don't have a mechanism to get the force from the place where it is to the place where it needs to be, and without creating a make the energy up thing, because they mistakenly threw all the energy in the universe basically into bent space, and they don't know how to get the bent space energy back. Fuck. Well, look, I've made these arguments. I'm just saying that I've made the short list video, you know, where I just went through the short list of all the stuff the current model is dependent on and how all of it is interdimensional garbage, and that you can choose to say, okay, you like that interdimensional garbage bullshit, but I'm giving you an explanation that's physical, cause and effect, and no extra dimensions and no superpowers.
In order to make the calculation doable for us with the math we're using. They are the math we're using.
He's a troll.
I'm just saying, so the math makes energy, creates energy to do something, and then it just erases the energy. Okay, cool.
A fucking lying troll.
No, but I've been thinking about the fact that maybe I should bring out the troll. It's been 20 years, and if you guys are just going to be trolling me and doing this kind of thing where you go off in this direction acting like you're responding to me and you don't even remember, it's an accusation of hypocrisy. So I'm going to come back for part two. Right.
Yeah, well, whatever. I think I've demonstrated who's the one who's been dishonest in this conversation. That's all I can say. your accusations are lazy and undetailed, and your critiques are superficial. So, we'll leave it at that. So, I don't know how long his second video is. Let's see. 19 minutes. Yeah. Well, we'll save that for another day, and such, so forth and whatnot. Try to take better notes, maybe, but it's probably just going to be more of the same. Probably. I mean, he just glossed over one of the biggest subjects, which is it's okay to misrepresent the double slit experiment, and because it's the nail in the coffin evidence. So it's the nail in the coffin argument for wave theory, and yet they misrepresent the details. And that to you isn't an indication that maybe it's weaker evidence than they claim.